Amen. Praise His wonderful name.
We have come to seek Your face.
Seek Your face. Church Pune. It's dangerous times we are living in, but also for the children of God, every day is a good day. Every day is a blessed day. So we just need to be assured of that God is in control. That God still is there upon His throne. He is still in control of the affairs of this world. He is still in control of all the affairs of the nations. This week, the biggest largest democracy goes to elections, and you mean to say God is sitting there chewing his fingernails as though whether it will be Trump or Biden, one of these two gentlemen. Gentlemen, because we need to respect the office that they are. So, but God is in control. He has already ordained. He's already decreed. He's already written who will be the next president of the United States. And that's why we can live in a life of peace, assurance. We can have a calmness in our spirit. We can have a peace that passes all understanding. It's not the peace that the world gives, or the newspaper gives, or the television gives, or the technology gives, or my spouse gives. It's the peace that my Savior gives me. That's what is so precious. It's the peace that comes from the Prince of Peace. It's the peace that comes from the source of peace, and that's what makes us different from the people that do not have that peace. And I hope and pray that we will continue to rest and continue to grow in that peace and continue to live our lives in that peace, no matter what's happening around us. It's not easy as it sounds, but I hope the Lord will give us more grace, and the Lord will strengthen us, and the Lord will help us in these days. As we were looking at the lesson on Friday night, this is a time where we as a church, and we as individuals. It's not only for the individuals, it's also for the church. It's not only for the church, it's also for the individuals. We as individuals need to repent and return to the Lord. It's very important. If there's any message that the world needs to hear in these days, is repent and return to the Lord. As the Lord has given us a space, a small space to repent and return to Him, let's do that, saints. Let's repent and let's return to the Lord. That's the cry of the Lord. That we looked at the heart of God. And the scriptures are the heart of God. He is still waiting for all His children to come to Him. He is still waiting. He is the same God yesterday. He is the same merciful God. He is the same all-powerful God. He is the same all-knowing God. God has not changed. Neither will He change. It's time for us to change, saints. It's time for us as individuals to change and to stop living in sin and to stop being led by our emotions and our will. Now it's time that we live a life that will bring glory to the name and to the very greatness of God. People, when they look at us, they should praise the Lord. People, when they look at us, they should say that I want to serve the God that you serve. They should not be attracted to us, but they should be attracted to the God that we serve. We need to live as I believe Paul told this to Timothy, that you should be blameless and harmless, the sons of God, without rebuke, in the midst of a crooked and a perverse generation, among whom you shine as lights in this world. I believe he told that to the church at Philippians, not Timothy. Philippians chapter 2, that we should be harmless and blameless, the sons of God, without rebuke. I mean, no one should be able to point a finger at us relating to our lifestyle and our conversation. But they should, heart in heart, they should know that these are the children of God that live by the word of God. And that's how we shine as lights in this dark world. And it's time, saints, it's high time that we repent and we return to the Lord. And that's one of the ways we can be obedient to the words of God. See, we can't be obedient if we are not facing Christ. We can't be obedient if we have not returned the Father. We think that we are obedient, but since when the Word of God talks about obedience, it implies immediate obedience. It implies total obedience, and it implies joyful obedience, or obedience with gladness. As I said, it implies immediate obedience. It's not that God has told us to do something and we do it 5 months later, or even 5 days later. That's delayed obedience. And someone said, delayed obedience is not obedience. Delayed obedience is disobedience. So when the Bible talks about obedience, what does obedience imply? Obedience according to my will and my time and my comfort. It's immediate obedience. It's total obedience. If God has told me to obey something, I don't obey it partially. Partial obedience again is disobedience. Partial obedience is disobedience. And the third thing, obedience is joyful. I obey with gladness. If I obey the word of God with murmuring, if I obey the word of God with a grudge and with a heaviness and with force, well, that is disobedience again. Oh, but I'm obeying. Well, the Lord not only loves a cheerful giver, but the Lord also loves a cheerful, obedient son or daughter. See, Paul said again to the church at Philippi, he said, Philippians 2, that do all things. Do all things means what? Obey. If you can paraphrase a scripture in Philippians 2 verse 14, he was saying obey without murmuring and disputing. See, obey. And I believe the next verse is what I quoted a few moments ago, that you will be blameless and harmless. See, how do I prove that I am a son of God or a daughter of God? When I obey without murmuring, without disputing, without feeling bad, or with a sense of pride that I have sacrificed so much for the Lord, and no one has obeyed God like I have obeyed God. Well, that's obedience coupled with pride is also disobedience. See, it's so important, saints. It's not, you may say, oh, this is going a little deeper and harder. Well, it's not hard. How do we want your children to obey? How do we want my children to obey us? How do we want them to obey? Well, we want to obey them the moment we tell them to obey, right? We want them to obey everything that we ask them to. And we want them to do it joyfully or with gladness. Well, if we being evil can expect these things from our children, and we do expect, how much more a loving God who has done so much for us, how much more does He expect obedience from us, which has to be total, which has to be immediate, and which has to be joyful? Now tell me if I'm saying anything wrong. And this type of obedience brings God's favor upon me. Otherwise, I'll only be under a general favor of God, a general grace of God. But if I want to be under that peculiar grace of God, well, I need to be a peculiar son and daughter which obeys God the way God wants me to obey. There's a scripture here in Job, the 36th chapter. Well, I forgot to turn on the timer. Job chapter 36. Job chapter 36 and verse 11. This is Elihu speaking to Job, and he's talking about God correcting his children and opening their ear to discipline, and he wants them to return from iniquity, return to him. And he says in verse 11, Job 36 verse 11, if they obey and serve him. Now this again, if they obey, how? Obey immediate, obey totally, and obey joyfully. Gladly. See, if they obey and serve Him, they shall spend their days in prosperity and their years in pleasure. That's God's word. That's God's word. But if they obey not, or if they obey partially, or if they obey a little later, or if they obey with heaviness and with a grudge or sad, if they are sad that they are obeying God's word. If they obey that way, they shall perish by the sword, and they shall die without knowledge. See, it's not important what we do only. Hear me out fully. It's not just important what we do, it's important how we do, or in what spirit are we obeying. Our attitude when we obey is very important. Just like they say that they that wait upon the Lord. Wait how? Wait with complaining and murmuring? Wait with a frown on our face? Or no? They that wait with the right spirit through it all. They that wait with the right attitude shall renew their strength. And the same way, they that obey completely, they that obey immediately, and they that obey joyfully will spend their days in prosperity and their years in pleasure. Delayed obedience, partial obedience, and obedience with murmuring is disobedience. And we all are so guilty of this. We all are so guilty of this lifestyle. We all fall into one of these categories. See, some of us obey, but we obey it later. Some of us obey, but we obey only partially. Some of us obey, but we obey with murmurings and complaining. That's not obedience, that's still disobedience, and we fall in one of these categories, and then God has to put us through trials. Then God has to put us through the grind. Then He has to put our back against the wall. And then, hear me out, then we obey out of desperation, but not out of obedience. See, when my back is put against the wall and there's no place, then I have to obey. But that obedience is out of desperation to come out of that situation, and that obedience is not out of obedience. Despair drives us to obey God instead of love driving us to obey God. Despair should never drive us to obey God, but it still does. I have obeyed God in my despair many times. First, God nudges us, and he calls us in love. See, despair drives us to obey God. Excuse me. Instead of love driving us to obey God, but that's how God works, saints. God will get us where we need to be, even though He has to make things hard sometimes. Well, we don't need to point fingers to anyone. We can tell that by experience, that how many times God has told us to do something, but we haven't done it. And we had to go through some hard situations to obey Him. We all can testify to that. We all can. Here in Psalms, the 32nd chapter. Psalms 32. This is again a psalm of David, and the first time we hear the, if you look at the in the title of this psalm, it's written Maskil, a psalm of David, and it's a Maskil. That means this is an instructive psalm. This is the first time this word Maskil comes in the book of Psalm. It's an instructive psalm. This is a psalm of instruction, and chronologically they say that this psalm has to come after Psalms 51. When David was corrected by Nathan the prophet, and when he repented, historians say that this has to come after Psalms 51. And this is what David is saying. And I don't want to read the entire psalm, but here I want to go to verse 8. See, God says, there are two types of people. God says, He says, I will instruct thee and teach thee in the way thou shalt go. See again the word instruct. I will instruct you and teach you in the way which you shall go. I will guide thee with mine eye. See, he just has to has to like some of our children are so used to our eye, they just understand the language of our eyes. You don't have to speak to them, but they know looking at your eyes whether you're pleased or whether you're displeased. So God says, I will guide you with mine eye. But there's another group of people in verse 9. He says, but be you not as the horse and the mule, which have no understanding, whose mouth must be held in pit and bridle, lest they come near to thee. See, David says there are two ways to do God's will. First is in verse 8, where he guides us with his eyes. And the second is that we have to be pulled like a horse and a donkey and a mule with bit and bridle. The keep a finger here, but in Proverbs, the 26th chapter. Proverbs 26 and verse 3. It says, a whip for the horse, a bridle for the donkey, and a rod for the fool's back. So who all needs a whip? A horse, a donkey, and a fool needs a whip, a bridle, and a rod. How long are we going to stay like a wild horse and a donkey and a fool? See, again, the scripture says in James 3. James, the third chapter. James chapter 3 and verse 3. James says, behold, we put bits in the horse's mouth that they may obey us, and we turn about their whole body. See, for a horse to be obedient to the jockey, he has to be the bit and the bridle, he has to be bridled. The bridle and the bit has to go through his nose. That's how he understands the instructions of the jockey that's sitting on his back, when to turn right or left. The horse doesn't understand the looks on the master's face. He can't be guided with his eyes, with the master's eyes. No, and if we are just guided and brought to obedience by bit and bridle, since we are still like the horse and the beast of the field. But it's time that we graduate and we mature to be sons and daughters, where we are not always brought to obedience with bit and bridle, but we can just look at the eyes of our Father, our Master, and understand what He wants us to do. That's maturity. God directs us, but we don't always obey. And then He has to use bits and bridles and bridle us sometimes. He always tells us the way we should go and the way we should not go, because He wants us to respond when He tells us to respond. Sometimes when we delay obedience, well, He has to put bit and bridle us so that we come back and obey Him. When we only obey Him partially, He has to again bring us on the right track where we completely obey Him. And when we obey with a grudge, He still has to deal with our life, where we'll come to a level in our life where we'll obey Him willingly. See, but so often, saints, so often we all have to be severely chastened before we will obey. Well, if you are right now going through something like that, it's okay. I'm not here condemning anyone, because we all go through this. We all sometimes have to be severely chastened. And that chastening, it says in the book of Hebrews, every chastening at the present doesn't seem joyous, but grievous. Nevertheless, afterwards, it yielded the peaceable fruit of righteousness in whom it is exercised thereby. See, but we don't have to go through chastening to yield the peaceable fruit of righteousness, saints. We can still obey the moment God tells us with a willing heart, and completely obey it, and still yield the peaceable fruit of righteousness. We don't always have to. See, the devil puts us in a mindset that unless we are chastened, we will not obey. That's what the devil tells us. Unless we are chastened, brother, if you are wrong, God will chasten you. But if you are right, He won't chasten you. See? Verse 8, it says in Psalm 42, verse 8, I will instruct thee and teach thee in the way that thou shalt go. I am there, God says, I will do that. I will guide thee with mine eye. The center column reference says, I will counsel thee with mine eye upon thee. And Charles Spurgeon, in his book, The Treasury of David, when he goes to the Psalm, he explains this verse. And when he explains this verse, he gives an example of a king, of a banquet hall, where a king is sitting at the table, and all his servants, just think about the example, where it's a banquet hall, and the king is sitting at the table, and all his servants are standing against the wall, and the king, when he's eating something, he doesn't have to speak a word. But the servants exactly know, looking at the gesture of the king, when the king needs something else, when the king has stopped eating, when he needs the second course and the third course and the fourth course and the fifth course or seven course meal, and when he needs a dessert and when he is ready to get up from the table. The king doesn't even have to mention and scream and shout to any of those servants, but they just look at the king's eyes and the gestures of the king, and they understand exactly what the king needs. That's how we need to have a relationship with our Father, where he doesn't have to yell and scream and shout and put us through trials and pain and agony for us to obey him, but we just look at his face. That's why I say it's very important to seek his face. That's why it's very important to be in touch with the Master, in relationship with our Father, where we are looking at him always. As I said last time, every morning we wake up, saints, we are faced with two choices: to seek his face or to seek the face of the world, or to seek the face of our pains or our weaknesses. Well, let's try and let's exercise our will that we will seek the face of the Lord continually. And when we seek his face, saints, we know every gesture of his eye. That's how it's the guidance from the slightest movement of God that makes me to understand and then obey what he wants me to do. Charles Spurgeon says that they are so in tune with the king that the slightest movement of the king's body, they perfectly understand what the king wants. And that's how we also need to work towards bringing up our children. It's not just shouting and yelling at our children that will discipline them. Someone says that rain and thunder never grew plants. It's the light showers and the sunshine that makes the seed, that makes the plant to grow. The plant doesn't grow in rain and thunderstorms. Some of us parents just scream and shout. Well, that's not going to bring obedience. That child will obey, but it will be a delayed obedience. It will be a non-willing obedience, and it will always be a partial obedience. That's what it means to bring up our children in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. That we are so sensitive to the Holy Spirit and to the nudges of the Holy Spirit and to the promptings of the Holy Spirit in our lives. The Holy Spirit is not something, the Spirit of the Lord will not scream and shout inside of us. Jeremiah, one of the prophets, says that I heard a still small voice. That's the voice of God through the Holy Spirit. It's a still small voice. Am I sensitive to that still small voice? See, since one look, as I said last time, one look of Jesus was enough for Peter to understand what he did. Jesus didn't have to scream and shout and throw up a tantrum there and show Peter a fist like that. See, Peter, I told you that you're going to deny me. See, I told you, Peter, see that? Oh no, but one look of the Master's face and Peter understood what he did. That's why it's so important to have our eyes fixed on the Master. That's why it says in Hebrews 12 verse 2 that looking unto Jesus, our Christ. Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross. Or if not verse 8, if we are not sensitive to the master, then verse 9. Then as the horse and the mule which have no understanding. That means like a fool whose mouth must be held in bit and bridle. Then comes the trials. Then comes those trying circumstances. Then comes that sickness. Then comes that problem on the job. Then comes that unrest. That's a bit and brittle, saints, that the Lord is trying to get our attention to him. See, God would love to guide us with his eyes. But why most of the time, saints, it has to be the pain that drives us to obey God? Why do we wait for pain to obey God? Why can't we obey God? That's including me. Why can't we obey God when the Lord just tells us lovingly and just guides us through his eyes? Why do we wait for pain? And since this pandemic is God's wake-up call, this is not a bit and brittle still. Still, it's not. It's just God's gesture with his eyes telling the world that something disastrous and something dangerous is coming ahead. This is just a small nudge from God. This is an act of his mercy still for his children I'm talking about. Well, it's judgment for the world, but it's a wake-up call for his children that let's get accustomed to seek his face. Let's stop living the way we lived and behaving the way we behaved and screaming and shouting and showing that awful spirit that we did all these years. Saints, there is still forgiveness if we go to the Lord and return to the Lord. I hope we learn and learn quick and we learn for once. Let's not be like the beast that don't have understanding. See, right now the lockdown is being eased a little bit in some nations. And people are getting back to their old ways. Well, the second and the third wave still hits, right? And some of the nations in Europe are going back into lockdown. Well, how many lockdowns will it take for us to wake up? I was reading the news yesterday. France announced lockdown and people were trying to get out of France. And if you think that the traffic in Pune and Bombay is bad, well, there was a 700 kilometer long traffic jam in France for people to get out. 700 kilometer long traffic jam. People want to run away from the pandemic, but no one wants to run towards God. Well, running away from this pandemic is not going to help us. Running towards God is what is going to help us. Where can I flee from your presence? Or where can I flee from your judgment? Let's try everything that's there in the book out in the world. It's not going to help us. But try the things that are written in this book, and this book will help us, saints. Let me give you an example of a well-known man and one of the president and the prime minister of Egypt. Let me give an example of Pharaoh. Exodus chapter 9 and verse 27. And Pharaoh sent. This is when the plague of hail and all those plagues were going on. Those 10 plagues were still upon Egypt. Pharaoh was in the midst of an epidemic, you can say. It was for Egypt. So he was in the midst of this. He was in the midst of the COVID-19 of that time. Okay? And he knew that he can't do anything. Verse 27, and Pharaoh sent and called for Moses and Aaron and said unto them, I have sinned this time. Oh, you can say, oh, wow, he's accepted. Well, let's read ahead. I have sinned this time. The Lord is righteous. And I and my people are wicked. Well, he had right words, but a wrong heart. He had the right words, but a wrong heart. Let's look at it ahead. Verse 28, he tells Moses and Aaron, entreat the Lord, for it is enough that there be no more mighty thunderings and hail, and I will let you go, and you shall stay no longer. And Moses said unto him, as soon as I am gone out of this city, I will spread abroad my hands unto the Lord, and the thunder shall cease, neither shall there be any more hail, that thou may know how that the earth is the Lord's. But as for thee and thy servants, I know that you will not yet fear the Lord. Moses knew. Moses had the spirit of discernment that this is just words, this is just hot air, but the heart's not right. And it says in verse 33, but the wheat and the river were not rye, were not smitten. Okay, let's read verse 33. But the wheat, and Moses went out of the city from Pharaoh and spread abroad his hands unto the Lord, and the thunders and hail ceased, and the rain was not poured upon the earth. Verse 34, and when Pharaoh saw that the lockdown has ended, when Pharaoh saw the COVID-19 has stopped spreading, when Pharaoh saw that the rain and the hail and the thunders were stopped, what did he do? He sinned yet more. Revelation 9, Revelation 16, we read last time, when about 2 billion, 3 billion people die, people are still not repenting and turning to the Lord. Nothing different here. Around 4,500 years ago, nothing different. He says, he sinned yet more and hardened his heart, he and his servants. God forbid that we, when I say we, I mean we as individuals, we as family, and we as a church. God forbid that we would go back to our old ways after this COVID-19. And God is speaking so explicitly unto us saints. He's speaking so explicitly today again in this service. God is telling us that let my word guide you. Let my eyes guide you and not pain. Why do you want pain every time? God is asking us. Why do we need pain and agony? Why can't mine eyes guide you? Why can't my word guide you? But sometimes it does take a painful experience to make us change our ways. And this pandemic is a glimpse of God's bit and bridle to get us where He wants us to be. But saints, I don't want that way to be in my life. The scripture, there's another beautiful scripture in Proverbs chapter 20 and verse 30. It says, the blueness of a wound cleanseth away evil. See, sometimes we have to be beaten black and blue, as they say. Sometimes we have to be beaten black and blue, and sharp afflictions need to come upon us so that the evil in us can be cleansed away. The blueness of a wound cleanseth away evil, so do stripes or chastening or the rod of his affliction the inward parts of the belly. The rod drives away foolishness out of us. And this pandemic is a small rod of God. And if we understand, says, let it drive away the foolishness and the hardness of our hearts. Let's change and mend our ways. Let's speak words of words with grace, seasoned with salt. Let's have the right thoughts. Let's look unto the Lord. Let's seek His face continually. Let's all examine ourselves. What does God want us to do, and what change does the Lord want in me? And says, I want to see to it that I change my life based on God's voice and not painful experiences. I want Him to counsel me with His eyes more, and not just with bit and bridle. And you know what that means, to be counseled with His eyes? To be a Christian 24/7. To be a Christian that is led by God and kept by God 24/7. Whether days are good, whether days are evil, whether COVID or no COVID, we will still serve you, Shadrach, Meshach and Abednego. We will still serve you, God. Whether this COVID is here to stay or whether you take it away, but we will still serve you, O God. Whether the pandemic stays or stops, we need to be sensitive to the leadings of the God, to the leadings of God and to the promptings of the Holy Spirit. Saints, this COVID-19 better teach us this. The Lord wants us to be sensitive to His leadings on our life. How long will we be stubborn? Well, the Lord's not short of plagues. There are a lot of plagues that He can allow. He's not short of experiences. He has a lot of them. It's not His will that we need to be in pain and go through painful experiences every time. It's not His will. It's we who are so stubborn and hard-hearted that we don't want to change. We are used to that bit and brittle. But we still don't want to seek His face and be counseled with His eyes upon us. We are so used to bit and brittle. We are so used to chastisement that we think unless we are not chastised, something's wrong. Well, people think that it's only chastisement that proves that I am a son. See, that's how the devil can twist the scriptures. Oh, if he's not chastising you, it's okay. Only when he chastises you, it proves that you're a son. Since I'm not saying that we will live a chastisement-free life. Well, he will still chastise us for things, but can't we make that chastisement a little less? Can't we make those painful experiences less a little bit? Are we continually from one experience into other, to the third, to the fourth? Do we need to always live in those painful experiences continually? Then what kind of a son are we if we have continually painful experiences that we are going through? Let's think on that. Let's think on that. Here, I quoted the scripture last time in Psalms 27. I just quoted it. I didn't turn to it. Let me turn to it today. Psalms 27 and verse 8. David says, "When thou said, seek you my face, my heart replied." What does the center column reference say? "My heart said unto thee, thy face, Lord, will I seek." That was David's response. This is not a man in Psalms 32 verse 9 that has to be pulled with bit and brittle. This is not a man. This is a man that knows the gestures of his father. This is a man that is counseled with his eyes and led by the eyes of God. And I want to be the man that hears his voice more and not just painful experiences. What is the Lord trying to tell me now? What is the Lord trying to tell us now? What is the Holy Spirit convicting you on the inside? It may be different convictions for different people, saints. What is it trying to tell us? Is it trying to tell me to repent? What am I doing with it? Is it asking me to turn to the Lord once again and return to Him? Well, what do I do with it? Do I obey it immediately? Do I obey it fully? Do I obey it gladly? Is it telling me to apologize to someone? What am I doing with it? Is it asking me to forgive someone? What do I do with it? Is it asking me to control my mouth so that I don't speak those flowery words out of my vocabulary? Is it asking me to be a little considerate to my spouse? Is it asking me to be a little gentle? Is it asking me to love my wife like Christ loved the church? Is it asking me to obey and respect my husband like the church respects Christ? Is it asking me to turn from my wicked ways and seek the Lord? I'm sure it's asking me to do something. Well, what am I going to do with it after this service is over? How will we respond to this? I want to encourage all of us saints, let's not delay obeying God's voice. Let's not just partially obey God's voice. Let's not wait for pain and then turn to the Lord. Let's do it with gladness and with a singleness of heart. The scripture many times says that, I believe in Deuteronomy 30, that you obey with all your heart and your soul. Deuteronomy 30. Obey with all your heart and soul. See, obey without murmuring and disputing and complaining and grumbling. Obey fully and totally. Let's be those people, saints. Let's be that individual first, and let's be that family first, and only then we will be that church. Let's not blame the church. There's no problem with the church. I have a problem with my heart. I have a problem with the hardness of my heart. I have a problem with rebellion and rebellion in me. The word of God is right. The preaching is right. The teaching is right. It's me that I am dull of hearing and still blind to see the gestures of the eyes of my Savior. Well, let's ask the Lord to open up the eyes of our understanding. That's what it means, that our eyes of understanding may be enlightened. To see what? To see what? To see those dirty, nasty, X-rated movies or R-rated movies? To see what? To see the world and the advertisements of the world, and to buy the things that are on the billboards out on the road and what comes on our mobile? To see what? We need our eyes of understanding to be enlightened to see the face of our Savior. And to see His word more clearly. That's why we need our eyes of understanding enlightened, saints. That's why we need it. Let's ask God to open up our eyes of understanding. And even though it means to humble, since obedience cannot be done with pride, let me tell each and every one of us, if we are in pride, we will never obey the way God wants to obey. Pride will either make us to partially obey, or delayed obedience, or unwilling obedience. That's what pride does. But we need to be really humble to obey God completely, totally, without any pain, without any grumbling, and immediately. We need humility, saints. We need to be humble. If it means to rub our nose in the dust, if it means to, don't think about someone else when you're hearing this message. Let's think about us. The devil puts a picture of somebody else before our eyes. Right now we may be having a lot of faces in front of us. See, this message is for him, for her. Listen. And for me? No. No, it's not for me. That's what the devil does. But a humble man, a humble woman will say, this is for me. For me. Thank you, Lord, for guiding me with your eyes today. Lord, I pray that you open my eyes of understanding, and you open my ears that have been so dull of hearing. Lord, give us a heart that will perceive. Help us, O God. Let's cry to the Lord. Let that prayer be continually in our heart 24/7. Let that unceasing prayer be a prayer of our life that keeps on going in our hearts. Even though when we are working or doing anything, that's a prayer that continually pray without ceasing. What? Just heal me, bless me. No, Lord, help me. Help my unbelief. Lord, open my eyes more and more. Lord, give me grace that I will rule over sin and grow in your word, grow in your spirit, Lord. That should be a prayer continually in our heart. Lord, help me to understand deception. It's all spiritual first and then everything else. May God help us, saints. May God help us. May God help us through this pandemic. Let's get our acts right. Let's pull up our socks. Let's wake up out of our sleep. The Lord's speaking to us plain. And I don't think so. There's a lot more plainer God can go. Well, if we still can't hear it, that means there's something really, really drastically wrong. We are spiritually retarded, maybe. Spiritually retarded. We only look good on the outside, but inside, we are a spiritually retarded person. Well, God can heal even that. If that retarded, spiritually retarded person can cry to the Lord, if he can turn Nebuchadnezzar back to a man from a beast, well, we have hope. We still have hope. Let's turn to the Lord. Let's seek his face. Let's be obedient to his word. And let's ask him to counsel us and guide us with his eyes. Amen. Thank God for our church. Thank God for this service. Let's continue to pray for our spiritual growth, saints. Let's continue to ask the Lord to create a clean heart and a right spirit within us. Purify our hearts, O God. Help us, for out of it are the issues of life. Let's keep our heart with all diligence. Let's have a life that is so addictive. When people look at us, they should be drawn to Christ. Let's live in a spiritually addicted life, just like the house of Stephanus had addicted themselves to the work of the Lord. Let's have our life that's addicted to live like Jesus Christ. Let's have that desire in us, and let's pray for that, and let's pray for the needs of the church. Let's pray for the ministry, the services throughout the body of Christ. Let's pray for the saints of God throughout the body that has been affected with this virus. And many saints have lost their loved ones. Let's pray that the Lord comforts and strengthens them also. And let's pray that the Lord helps each and every one of us here. Let's not forget to pray for Brother and Sister Sanjeet. They have sent the church their love and their regards. And they pray and they love each and every one of us. So let's pray for them too. Let's have the Lord to have his hand upon them and cover them. And similarly cover the churches in the body of Christ. And help each and every family and minister and saint. Amen. Let's all pray. Father, we thank you for being with us once again today. Thank you for your word, O Father, that still leads us and guides us. Thank you for your mercies, O Lord, and your goodness that leads us to repentance. Father, as you have spoken your words to us, we want to implement these words in our lives. Father, we just don't want to be accustomed to pain and trials. Father, but we want you to guide us with your eyes, O Father, and with your hand, with your word. Father, we just don't want the rod always, but help us to be sensitive to the promptings of your word and the Holy Spirit. Father, I pray to touch the eyes of understanding of each and every one of us, and open up our ears which are dull of hearing, and give us a heart of flesh, O God, where we won't be hardened and hardened and hardened, but help us to be receptive. Help us, O God, to turn and face you and seek your face as an individual, as families, and as a church. Be with us, O Father. We ask your covering, we ask your leading and your protection upon each and every one of us and our families. The sick among us, Lord, touch them. And let your healing be made perfect in their bodies and use them for your glory. The churches throughout the body of Christ, Lord, the Sunday services throughout, brethren and sisters, Sanjeev, continue to touch them, be with them and protect them. And be with us all till we come back Wednesday night. Be with us, O Lord. Let your presence lead us and guide us. And let your word help us. Help us to accustom ourselves, not just to pain, but to your eyes and to your face.
In Jesus' name we pray, Father. Amen.
God bless you.